We all know coffee is great for energy, for alertness, to keep us awake. But did you know that coffee can deliver all kinds of metabolic benefits and might even help you prevent cancer? Today, we're going over five little known benefits of coffee. You could say we're going to spill the beans. Studies show caffeine lowers what we call resting metabolic rate. Basically, the amount of calories our body burns at rest, just sitting there, just to maintain its basic physiological functions. But caffeine may also reduce hunger and increase satiety, satiation. So it's kind of a double whammy. It increases the amount of calories we burn, and it lowers the amount of calories going in. So this combo should result in some weight loss, right? And in fact, a meta-analysis of 13 randomized trials found that caffeine can help reduce body weight, BMI, and body fat. Now, this is a modest effect. It's not a massive effect. Okay, so it's not like I could just pig out and then sip some espresso and undo all the effects of the overeating. It doesn't work that way. So healthy diet still applies, but maybe this can help nudge things in the right direction. Also very important to distinguish sources of caffeine. Black coffee is one thing, and those drinks from fast food joints that look like an ice cream cone are a completely different beast. Those can pack up to 1,000 calories in the most extreme cases. And the same goes for energy drinks. Many of those are high in added sugars and calories, so it absolutely matters where we get our caffeine. But the metabolic benefits of coffee don't end there. Coffee drinkers have a lower risk of developing diabetes. And that's even after adjusting for BMI, exercise, smoking, alcohol, and different aspects of diet. Interestingly, this effect seems dose-dependent, up to high amounts like 10 cups a day. Although recommendations are usually to not go much higher than 4 cups a day, give or take, because excess caffeine can cause symptoms, can cause issues like jitteriness, headaches, anxiety, and irritability, especially in people who are caffeine sensitive. But of course, this varies from person to person. Now, very interesting, this link to lower risk of diabetes is seen both with regular and decaf. So it doesn't seem to be about the caffeine. So how could coffee have these effects? Well, one possibility are these compounds contained in coffee called chlorogenic acids. They have an effect on metabolism and weight gain, weight loss. So that's one candidate to try to explain these metabolic effects of coffee. Benefit number three is no less impressive. Research suggests that coffee might benefit our brain function. For example, coffee drinkers have a lower risk of developing Parkinson's disease. And even among patients who already have Parkinson's diagnosed at an early stage, coffee drinkers have a slower progression of the disease. And similar to what we saw for diabetes, this link also seems dose-dependent, up to very high amounts of 10 cups a day or maybe even more. Interestingly, this link does seem to be about caffeine because we see it with regular coffee, we don't see it with decaf, and we do see it with tea, which, depending on the type of tea, contains caffeine as well. So if you're not a coffee drinker, that's another option. And speaking of the brain and the nervous system, this is fascinating. Did you know that caffeine can help with pain relief? Okay, how is caffeine pulling that off? It actually works as a chemical imposter. Our body naturally produces this molecule called adenosine. And adenosine inhibits neuronal activity, so it's kind of an off switch for neurons. In fact, this is how sleep works. Adenosine builds up over the course of the day, and it binds a specific receptor on the surface of neurons and triggers that receptor to turn off specific neurons, which makes us sleepy. So this is where caffeine comes in, because the structure, the molecular chemical structure of caffeine kind of looks like adenosine. So it acts as an imposter. It's close enough that it can bind the same receptor, but it can't trigger it. So it just occupies the spot like a squatter and doesn't let adenosine bind and do its thing and make us sleepy. So this is how caffeine keeps us awake. And pain works similarly. So adenosine plays a role in pain, what we call nociception, and caffeine counters the effect of adenosine. So one study showed that a dose of caffeine, equivalent to about a cup of coffee, improved the effect of common painkillers like ibuprofen. In fact, some brands of over-the-counter painkiller include caffeine in their formulation. All right, that's really cool, right? But the last benefit is no less impressive. There's substantial evidence that coffee can lower the risk of developing certain cancers. The evidence is strongest for uterine cancer and liver cancer. And it also seems to be dose-dependent for these as well. Now, when it comes to claims about cancer on social media, it's a good idea to be skeptical because it's the wild, wild west. People will say crazy stuff with no scientific evidence. But this link between coffee and cancer is strong enough, there's enough evidence behind it, that the American Institute for Cancer Research ranks it pretty high, enough to justify recommendations. And like we saw for diabetes, this link also pans out for both regular and decaf, so it doesn't seem to be about the caffeine either. One idea proposed by scientists is that it might be the phytochemicals in coffee. Coffee and coffee beans are actually very high in phytochemicals, these plant chemicals that have antioxidant and anti-inflammatory effects, among others. So that might be how coffee plays this role of countering certain cancer types. So overall, the science on coffee looks quite positive, a balance towards benefit in most people, but as always, there are some exceptions. In children, in pregnant or breastfeeding people, it's advised to limit or eliminate caffeine. And caffeine-sensitive people, we've touched on that, they can experience symptoms like anxiety. And finally, people who suffer from insomnia, obviously drinking a lot of coffee is not going to be a great idea, especially close to your bedtime. Here's a video with more information on how to reverse diabetes with diet. And here's the best workout to lower your blood pressure. I'll meet you over there, or over there, or over there. Bye-bye.